everyone, and welcome to another video. So today I'm going to be talking about the best books that I read in 2020. If you missed it, last week I put up a video about the worst books of 2020, so you can go check those out. But this is my official final list of the best books that I read this year, and they are in order from like less best to most best. That doesn't make sense. But like the number one book is the number one book that I read this year, like my absolute favorite book that I read this year. So let's just dive on in. So the first book I have on this list, I do not have a copy of, unfortunately, but it is The Program by Suzanne Young. So I read this book because it is one of my roommate's favorite books like ever, and she had been hyping it up for me all semester, and so I was like, yeah, I'll read it. So I got the audiobook for it, and I read it very recently, and I really enjoyed it. Also, I love the cover because it's so bright and it has yellow on it, and I love yellow. But so this book takes place in a sort of dystopian universe where there's a sort of pandemic. Relatable, I know, of suicide among teenagers. And in order to stop it, there's a sort of program. And so if parents or teachers are concerned that their kids have the like sickness of being suicidal, they can get sent to the program in order to sort of cure them. But within the program, they sort of like rewire their brains in order to make them not suicidal. But in the process of doing that, they delete like all of the people's memories, and it essentially just changes who you are as a person. And so when people come back from the program, they're just entirely different people, and they're really not supposed to interact with their old friends or their old life, and they're not supposed to ask questions about it. They're just supposed to live their life as this brand new person. So as you can see, there's a big downside to getting this cure for the disease of suicide. So a lot of teenagers would rather kill themselves than go to the program. And so that's sort of the controversy within this book, is that these kids don't want to go to the program because they don't want to have their mind messed with, but like their parents and teachers don't understand that that's what the program is doing to them. And so it totally just perpetuates the suicide. It just makes it even worse because people don't want to go to the program. Obviously, there are some trigger warnings for suicide in this book, because that's like a main topic that it covers. But also, I want to give a trigger warning for self-harm, depression, and sexual abuse. But overall, I really enjoyed this book, and I can't wait to continue with the series. I think that it has a lot of potential, and it's just a really interesting world to read about. Alright, so I didn't tell you this beforehand, I have 8 books on this list, so The Program was number 8, so this book is number 7 on my list. So book number 7 is The Selection by Kiara Cass. I read this as the first book in my December fantasy challenge, where I'm reading fantasy books in December, because I don't really like fantasy that much, so I'm trying to like broaden my horizons a bit. And I am vlogging that, by the way. The vlog will probably go up beginning of January, but I'm also posting TikToks. I was doing them every day, but I took a break for a couple days, but I'm gonna try to do them every day. So if you're not following my TikTok, it's down below, and if you wanted to like follow me in real time as I'm reading these books instead of waiting for the vlog, you can go check out my TikTok down below. So with this book, I was confused at first about the whole world that we're in. I don't really like world building. It's like the main reason why I don't like fantasy books, because I hate learning new worlds. And like with contemporary, they're just in our world, so like I don't need to learn it, you know? So I don't really like doing that. But so at first I was really confused with like the caste system and how that all worked, and she's like, oh, I'm a 6, and I'm like, I don't know what that means. A size 6? I don't know. And then like the whole royalty aspect, I kind of got the royalty stuff because it's just basic royalty, but the society they live in didn't really make sense to me at first. But it really didn't take me that long to learn the world and also the characters and how the caste system works. But basically, this book is a fantasy slash dystopian-ish world, and it's essentially like The Bachelor, where there's the one royal guy and there's a bunch of girls from different areas in their country who apply for the selection, and 35 girls are chosen, and eventually the prince will narrow it down to one girl who he's going to marry. And so our main character, America, is chosen for the selection, but she mostly entered into the selection because her mom wanted to, and her secret lover also wanted her to. And so, like, she really didn't want to be chosen. She doesn't want to be queen. She was just like, I'm never going to get chosen anyway. And so she enters in and is chosen. And so now she's, like, at the palace, and she's like, I don't want to win. And so her and Maxon, the prince, sort of become friends. She's like, I can help you out with knowing, like, how the girls really are, because in front of you, they're going to act differently, obviously. And so she sort of, like, develops this friendship with Maxon. And I really enjoyed that aspect, because the main character, she didn't want to win. And so it wasn't like she was sabotaging other girls. She wasn't, like, worried about what was happening. She was more just like, eh, this is what's going on, and I just want to be here as long as I can. I love that the relationship that grew out of this book. Like, we all know it was going to happen, but I loved when it did happen. I was like, I was like so excited about it. Although I was kind of surprised that the ending didn't end on a cliffhanger, because I know that this is a series. And so usually series like end on cliffhangers or something that would be kind of like a cliffhanger, something that would make you want to continue the series. And this book didn't really do that. It kind of ended on a happy note. And so, I mean, if I wasn't super into the story, I totally would just be fine with only reading the first book and not continuing. However, I did really enjoy it, so I am going to continue with the series. But I think that it could have done a cliffhanger to make it a bit better. Alright, number 6 on this list is The One Memory of Flora Banks by Emily Barr. This story follows a girl named Flora who has amnesia. She can't really remember what she's doing from like hour to hour. She just forgets all the things that she's done. And so in order to counteract that, she sort of like writes notes for herself all over, like writes on her arms, trying to remember things that she's done. But the one thing she can remember is that she kissed a boy. When her family leaves her alone for a few days, she decides that this boy is the answer to her amnesia. If she finds this boy, she is going to be able to remember things. And so she takes off, and I think she goes to Norway to follow this boy to where he went to for college and try to find him so she can get her memory back. I really enjoyed this book, mostly because Flora is an unreliable narrator. She's like, oh, I did this, but you never really know for sure if she did that because she can't really remember what's happening. And so you don't know what's happening. And so you're like kind of guessing throughout the whole story of whether or not she did do this thing, or if she just thinks she did it, or if she can't remember something that she did do and that's important. Like, there's a lot of things where you're just guessing about it, and I really like that aspect of it. However, the ending did take me by surprise. It was not the ending I was expecting, but I really liked it. Like, even though it was way different than what I thought it was going to be, it felt so fitting. It was a really great way to wrap up the story. So yeah, I really enjoyed this one. At number 5, we have Those Girls by Chevy Stevens. So I did not know much about this book going into it. I found it at like a Goodwill or something, and I just thought the cover was pretty. And I think I read the back, but I don't think I like read it too much. So I kind of just like grabbed it and just went on my merry way, not knowing what was in store when I read this book. I honestly thought it was going to be a lighter YA contemporary. I mean, like, based on the cover, doesn't it look like it's going to be like a light story, like a fun, like summery contemporary? No, that is not what it is at all. I'm actually pretty sure it's an adult book, and so I wish I kind of had known that going into it, but I mean, either way, I still really enjoyed it, so it's not that big of a deal. But basically, this follows the story of three sisters who live in an abusive household with their father, and after an incident happens, they end up on the run from their old life. But while they're on the run, another unfortunate incident happens. It's like one thing after another for these girls. Like, they just can't catch a break, and I feel so bad for them. However, about halfway through the book, it goes to like another timeline, like in the future, like 15 years in the future, and it follows the daughter of one of the sisters. So this book really stuck out in my mind, mostly because it was so graphic and it just really took me by surprise. I did enjoy it, so like the graphicness didn't like deter me in any way, but it just was very unexpected. And I will give trigger warnings for abuse, rape, sexual assault, death, and there's probably more. I tried to look it up on one of those like databases to make sure I didn't miss anything, but it like I couldn't find it anywhere. There might be more that I can't remember, so just be aware before going into it. I will also mention that the first half of this book is much more graphic than the second half of the book. Like, I remember reading the first half and I actually had to like put it down. I'm like, that was very intense, and I just had to like take a minute to like mentally like prepare myself to continue. Like, it was really good and really well done. It was just a lot to take in at once because I read like the first probably 150 pages in one sitting. After you get through the first half, the second half, while it does have some graphic things, it is not nearly as graphic or intense as the first half. So if you are reading it and you're like, wow, this is a lot, just know that the second half isn't as bad. Number four on this list, I also don't have a copy of, but I really want to get one. It's a little expensive right now. But that book is The Invisible Life of Addie LaRue by V.E. Schwab. So I love V.E. Schwab's writing. I love her Cassidy Blake series, and I've read The Monsters of Verity duology, and this one, and I'm really excited about this one. And I want to read some of her other books as well. Just haven't gotten there yet. But so this book was no exception to my love for her writing. So this follows a girl named Addie LaRue who is immortal, but everyone she meets, like, instantly forgets her. And so she's lived, like, 300 years just by herself in, like, solitude because nobody can remember who she is. But after 300 years of not being remembered, someone does remember her. I love the versatility of this story. We follow her in, like, present day, but we also follow her in the past from when this curse slash gift thing started, and then also like different spots throughout her life as well where like different important things happened. So I really liked that aspect, and also there are a couple times when you read from another person's perspective, and I really liked that too. But honestly, the romance in this book was so breathtakingly beautiful, and the ending was just amazing. I don't want to give anything away, but it was just perfect, and it fit the book so well. I honestly can't imagine it ending any other way. It was outstanding. So the next book, or rather books, is The Vision Trilogy by Lisa McMahon. I do have all three books, but I'm just holding up this one for convenience. So this trilogy is by Lisa McMahon, and she's the author of one of my favorite book series, Wake. And I talk about that series a lot. So if you've been around for a while, you've heard me talk about it. So I read all three of these books on audiobook, and I read them so fast. Like, I probably could have read them just as fast if I was physically reading them because they were so good. I just, like, devoured the story. And also, the covers are really pretty. Look at, ooh, shiny. Anyway, so this follows Jules, who starts to have this vision of a truck crashing into a building and the building exploding. And at first, she sort of just, like, shrugs it off, and she's like, oh, it's not that big of a deal, I'm just seeing things or whatever. Like, she's not really that worried about it. But as she continues to see this vision, she realizes that she's actually seeing the future, and she has to do anything in her power to stop what is about to happen. So I'm gonna give just a mild spoiler here for future book, because I don't think you wouldn't know this until the end of this book, but it's really not that big of a deal. But so the second and third books follow other people who have visions as well, but it's not just Jules. Jules has the vision in the first book, and in the second book, a friend of hers has it, and in the third book, somebody else has it. And I really like that aspect of the series, because even though you're only following Jules, like, in her head, you get to see what happens when she has a vision, and how she reacts when her friend and other people have visions as well. And I really like that aspect. It sort of gave it a little bit of variety. But yeah, really great book series, and I honestly just need to reread it because they're so good. Alright, number two on my list is Ninth House by Leigh Bardugo. So this book is fairly new. I'm sure lots of you have heard a lot of things about it. It came out like last year, I think. I started it in May, and I finished it in September. So that gives you a like idea of how long it took me to read this. But to be fair, I think I was in like two reading slumps within that time period, so I just wasn't reading anything a lot of that time. But also it was like one of those books that I just wanted to like take my time with. I didn't want to rush it. I just wanted to enjoy the story because there was so much happening in it. And I just loved like every second of it. So this book is about a secret society that's within Yale, and it has a lot of magic and like necromancy and rituals and ghosts. Like, there's a lot of like really crazy like paranormal spooky things that happen within this book. So we follow this girl named Alex as she is in Yale, and she's actually there like on false pretenses. The people who run the secret society, they wanted her in Yale, and so they give her like a fake GPA, a fake transcript in order for her to get in. And so I think she's really relatable in that way because she feels like an imposter like the whole time. Like, she knows that she's not as smart as everybody else who's there, and she doesn't feel like she knows enough about the secret society to be doing what she's doing for the secret society. And I really relate to that because I always feel like I don't deserve what I have, especially when it comes to academics. So I found that really relatable. But also, I loved Darlington. He is Absolutely. He's my new book boyfriend. I love him so much. He's amazing. And I actually loved the way it ended. It sort of ended on a cliffhanger. And so I'm really excited to see what's going to happen in the sequel. I'm so pumped to read the sequel, dude. You have no idea. But before I get done talking about this book, I wanted to give some trigger warnings for gore, drugs, death, rape, self-harm, and suicide. So be aware, there's a lot of really dark things going on in this book, but it was also really, really good. And the last book on this list, number one, the best book I read this year, was The Way I Used to Be by Amber Smith. So I picked this up on audiobook because the cover was pretty. That's literally the only reason. I knew nothing about it. I just saw it on Libby and I was like, pretty cover. It's probably contemporary. I'll read it. And boy, was I thrown for a loop. So we start off following Eden, who's in her freshman year of high school. And at the beginning of the book, she ends up getting raped by her brother's best friend. And so we follow Eden throughout her 4 years of high school as she's dealing with this trauma that she went through her freshman year and sort of how that impacts her throughout her whole high school career. There are definitely some really cute scenes in this book and some really impactful and intense scenes as well. And I just wanted to give some trigger warnings, obviously for rape, but also sexual abuse. This is the number one book that I've cried the most at. I literally just sobbed like the whole time I was reading it. It was so intense and so well done, and there was just a lot going on, and I cried so much. I honestly don't have words. I just was so in so many tears reading this book. But anyway, that is it for the best books that I read in 2020. I hope you all enjoyed this video. Like I said at the beginning of the video, I did do a worst books in 2020 video last week. So if you haven't seen that, click the card. But yeah, I think I had a pretty good reading year. I could have been better because I did have a couple of slumps. But overall, I read a lot of really good books. But thank you all so much for watching this video. If you liked it, please make sure you are subscribed down below so you don't miss any future bookish content from me in the coming year. And if you want to follow me on social media, all my links are in the description box down below, as they always are. Thank you all so much for watching, and I will see you in my next video. Bye!